I am Rebecca Shapiro from the Executive Secretary of the Dictionary Society, and this is something that the Dictionary Society started a couple of years ago because we wanted to have a really interesting exchange of ideas and people and contact in between the every other year conferences. So we started this in New York City because there's a concentration of wordy, lexy people. So today's, I'm going to steal Ben's words. So today's Metrolex is going to be, well, first of all, I want to thank John Porter for scheduling and also hosting the room and family, informing some students who are here. So the theme of today's session is going to be the lexicographical challenges of the transition from print to digital, in consideration of what is lost and gained in the process. We have John Morris, former president and publisher of Merriam-Webster, who's going to look at the rich supporting information or metadata found in a dictionary's traditional word galleries, much of which, like handwriting and date stamps, he wants his publisher to move to all digital Then Angus Creek Smith, he is a focus linguist. We'll consider that what happened with lexicographers in France created the equivalent of the OD, which is Ordre de la Langue Française. First incorporated digitized text, but based their corpus on the authority of literary critics, always a problem, providing an inadequate picture of the French language. So each of the two speakers is going to be roughly about 20 minutes. And please, it's always a question of whether or not to have talk questions, or talk questions. So maybe we can kind of get a sense of after the first talk if anybody wants to have questions, or they seem to be flowing together thematically if we would like to just open it up afterwards. We'll see. And any preference for who goes first? Would anyone like to, either of you like to get it over by your band-aid fast or band-aid slow? How about Angus?
Okay, well, thanks to those of you who made it out on this Air of Yom Kippur, and also nice, you know, cool fall day. So I'm going to be talking about a dictionary that was published in 1971, the year I was born, the Trésor de la Langue Française. And I wanted to tell you guys about this because I've been to, you know, some of the talks here where I've been in the past, people have said things like, well, you know, when people started using corpora for dictionaries in the 80s, and I'm like, no, it goes back further than that. So I've got a ton of stuff I can tell you guys about this. I'm gonna try and squeeze it into 20 minutes. So I'm gonna talk about the dictionary and some of the corpus projects that came out of it. I'm gonna talk about representative corpora, about a project that I'm working on that will hopefully be an improvement on the French text corpus, and some particular case study that could show you know, some of the deficiencies in the French text corpus. So the Dictionnaire de l'Académie Française was published in 1694. The Littré was a big dictionary, historical dictionary of French, published in 1863-1872. Then there was the OED and the Oxford English Dictionary, and that's sort of the context in which these French scholars started talking about a dictionary in French. So in 1957, there was a Romance Philology Roundtable in Strasbourg. And this guy, Paul Lenz, who was an Alsatian philologist, he sort of summarized the goals for a dictionary that came out of this roundtable. That it should be an answer to the OED and the Diccionario Hispanico de la Lengua Española. Apparently they had also announced plans for a similar Italian dictionary. I couldn't see any evidence of such an Italian dictionary being published. Maybe they just got too intimidated by the French. but in any case, they said, well, this should be an audience of specialists, linguists, philologists, historians of the French language, historians of ideas, institutions, and scientists. We want to have a generalized dictionary, and then a series of specialized lexica, and it should be a national project, and the fifth goal was it should be as aesthetically pleasing as possible, which is always good, right? But then they also talked about this, their target audience being the cultivated man. So it seemed a little bit, seemed like they weren't quite that focused on it. By the way, a lot of this this background comes from Anne's front matter too, because all the other people says, which is really fascinating. So they realized that, midway through the 14 years of collecting data for this dictionary, they knew about like modern computational methods, and they said this is what we want to do. And I think they sort of had an idea that Francis and Cuchero were starting to work on the round corpus, and then the American Heritage Dictionary was published 2 years before the Casal de la says. And that was based on, in part, on Brown corpus for usage. So they realized that they were limited by data entry throughput. They also realized they were limited by the power of the fastest computer produced in France at the time, the old Gamma 60, this is the data entry mechanism. Presumably, it wasn't so dusty back then. They entered all these texts on punch cards and paper tape, and they decided to limit their corpus to 70 million words in literary texts and 20 million words in technical texts. So they had a bunch of scientific texts and some conversation, but they realized that they felt like it would be difficult to they had this vision of a representative corpus, that would be like a random sample of some catalog. And they essentially gave up Parkbaser, and they fell back on something called the principle of authority. And he rationalized this by saying, we have renounced criteria of pure objectivity, these often being nothing but a sum of subjectivities checking each other. Yeah, okay. if that's what you have to say.
Parse that.
Yeah, well, it's objectivity. What does that mean anyway? So what they did was they chose generally recognized authorities. So they took a whole series, and they're listed in the front matter of literary histories of the 19th and 20th centuries, and basically tabulated a list of all of the literary works that were mentioned in those literary histories. And anything that was mentioned five times or more in the 19th century was automatically in. Anything that was mentioned more than three times in the 20th century, same thing. They considered for inclusion text mentioned two to three times. Presumably, Ames meant that also things that were considered four times, that were mentioned four times in the 19th century, were included. So that's basically what. There it is. Okay. All right. Okay. So let me exit. There we go. So here is the here's the entry for leak, and then pop. So there's a whole I don't know, you guys have a word for it, but there's the number two anyway for pa, which is the noun sense.
Edward.
What's that?
Edward,
okay. And my scan I should have reworded these. So the first one is the first adverb is pa as an adverb of negation. Right, so it's correlated with ne, it's interesting because the first citation is actually from 1789, from Jean-Paul Marat, the famous French revolutionary who was stabbed to death. I was talking with Rebecca about it. That seems to be from sort of the long 19th century, which apparently in French includes the French Revolution. They do have in the final corpus a bunch of stuff from the 20th century. From even the 18th century and the 17th century. So let's go past Calvinia. Okay, so there is a whole section about pa without without the ne, right? So pa de zèle, pa d'histoire, pa de blague, but these I think it's clear. There's some discussion of it as an informal. Okay, here we go. Popular or very familiar with suppression of ne. Right? For those of you who don't know anything about French, in standard French, negation is usually done. Sentences are negated with ne before the verb and pa after, and that has. That's a change that's been in course for a long time. But notice how the earliest citation is from 1945, right? And then later on there is a section in this. I don't know what ELL stands for. I didn't scan that page. So in these ELL contexts, there's also without ne, and it can go back to 1830. Okay? But most of the citations are about ne, and they're mostly like in response to something or something like that. So that's the basics of. Of what the says looks like. So basically they came out with this dictionary in 1971. And they also published some studies that were sort of, based on the corpus of the dictionary, as well as based on the entries of the dictionary. And they found that there was people started writing to them saying, well, can we get access to this corpus? And they, basically corpora started becoming popular in and of themselves. And they realized that they sort of had a product here in some sense. They also realized that the product was not in any sense ready for distribution. This guy, Robert Morrissey, who was American, who had lived in France, was then at the University of Chicago, said, well, we've got some resources in Chicago that we can, help with this. So they worked out an arrangement to to basically clean up the entire corpus, convert it to magnetic media, and make it available on the internet. And it was called ARTFL, which stands for American and French Research on the French Language. Mark Olson told me that the French people said, well, if it's American and French research, where's the F? And since we are the ones who created this corpus, shouldn't it be French and American research on it? And he said, well, then it would be ARTFL. So this is where I come into the picture. I play a minor role because in 1994, I was starting, the summer of 1994, I was about to start grad school at the University of Chicago. And I had not been able to find a summer job in the southern tier of New York, surprise, surprise. So I had I'd moved to Chicago in the middle of the summer, and I was working as a courier for a people trading pork bellies on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. And I was sitting in the courtyard of the International House, which was where I lived at the time. And I heard people speaking French at the next table, so I went over and introduced myself. And they said, oh yeah, we're semanticists from France who have been hired to work for the ARTFL project. You know, we could probably get you a job there. And I was like, okay, that's cool. It paid the same amount as being a courier. And I didn't have to commute, you know, it was like $4 long. So basically my job was to, they had gotten these first editions of basically every text in the corpus. And my job was to have the first edition there in the terminal there and make sure that they were the same, essentially. And there was a fair amount of cleaning up that needed to be done. So to give you a sense of what the ARTFL project looks like, you can do a search for example, and you can get concordances. You can also get key word in context. So that's basically what they were putting on the internet, and that was actually I remember when Mark Olson, I was in Mark Olson's office, and he said, look at this new thing that they have on the internet. They call it the World Wide Web. And I was like, wow, it's just gopher with pictures. I'm excited about that. So here shows how much I know about this. So then, in addition to ARTFL and Chicago keeping that stuff, they also gave it back to the French, so the French had a version of that online. They also distributed a version. Actually, you can get the dictionary now for free online, and they also distributed. But before that, they distributed it on CD-ROM. But I want to talk about the shortcomings of the corpus now. So in terms of linguistics, right, we have these theories in functional linguistics that, for example, the more lexical items that occurred in a certain position in the construction, the more likely it would be to extend to new items, right? So this was 4 years later, I was in a class with Joan Bybee at the University of New Mexico, and I wanted to test that theory of hers. And my classmates were all working on English, and I said, "Oh, English is boring." And I knew I worked on the ARTFL corpus, so I said, I have a corpus to work on, right? So I decided to look at negation and see if that applied to it, right? But there were problems with that, which is if you're thinking about the more lexical items that are heard in a certain position in a construction, so let's say at time one, the more likely it will be to extend to new items in the future, right? But how do you know what is her? So for example, if you imagine, let's say a playwright sitting down in, you know, 1810 to write a play and to use, you know, to put ne pas into his, you know, into the character's mouth. What did that playwright hear before, right? How did, you know, how can we get an accurate picture of what the playwright is trying to reproduce when he or she is sitting down? There were some women playwrights who were actually fairly successful in that period. When they're sitting down to write these plays. And that's where the principle of authority fails us, because it doesn't give us an accurate picture of that. So I said, well, can we do better? And so I was actually I was working on my dissertation. I used the Frantex corpus for that, which is the one that I worked on at Chicago. But I was working on 60th Street at the Alliance Française. They have a beautiful library there. And they had, just as you come in, a little cart where they had books for sale. And I noticed that they had all five volumes of The Parisian Stage, which is the life's work of this guy, Charles Beaumont Wicks from the University of Alabama. He made a list of every play that was produced in Paris in the 19th century. Five volumes published from 1950 through 1979. And I realized that you could sample that. Once you have the list of everything, then you can take, say, a 1% sample. And then there are all these new developments since 1970. Right? We've got high-quality OCR, we've got Google Books, and Gallica, which is the repository of the French National Library. We've got archive.org. I think they had microfilms in 1971, but there's a lot more of them than there were now, than there were back then. So in the Parisian Stage, there are over 31,000 plays. In the first volume, 1800 to 1815, there are 3,144 plays. So I said, okay, let's take 1% of that, I'll take 31 plays. And and I found that that of those 31 plays, there were three potential cataloging errors, plays that just didn't seem to be actually have been performed. There were, or at least not to have been performed in that period. There was one play that was only available in manuscript form. And then, like, about four others that just, that just couldn't be found. But I found I managed to collect a bunch of them, collect 24, and clean 18 of them, OCR them, and annotate 15 of them for negation. Actually, I annotated all 18, but there were three that were short, so I had to use them. And I've made this available on GitHub, so now you can go and get the clean copies of those. And they're not completely clean, you know, but if you want, you can help out by downloading them, picking them up, and checking them back in. So this is what I found in my dissertation. So I looked at print text. I just chose one text from it each 25-year period. And so in French, it turns out there was actually variation in negation. There were four possible ways to negate a sentence. You could do ne pas, or you could do ne with no pas. You could also do ne mi, and you could do ne point. So ne point, I'm sorry, ne mi was something that sort of had its heyday in the Middle Ages and basically was over by the 15th century. Ne point sort of had a heyday in the 17th and 18th century. and but you see how there was this dramatic rise from the 16th century to the 19th century in the but then I said, okay, well, let's compare those. Let me look at this this random sample of 15 plays that I just told you about and compare them to the four plays from 1800 to 1815 that were in the Grand Text Corpus. So there was the one that I had chosen for my dissertation, and then there were three more. And I found that 49% of the sentences were negated in the Grand Text Corpus, but in the corpus that I selected randomly, it was 75%. So, and so there was a lot more nukwan and a lot more nuk in the Frank text corpus. So, so where did that come from? I just wanted to point out also that when you do random sampling, you can, that sort of tells you that you really have a good picture of what was going on. And then you can stop and move on to something else. And that was the insight of, I don't know how many of you have taken statistics, but of William Seeley Gossett, who was known as Student, who came off the Student's T-test. He was actually a brewer for Guinness. And he wrote under a pseudonym so that the Guinness competitors wouldn't know what they were up to. But he basically said, if you have a random sample, then you can stop looking at things. Once you get statistical significance, you can stop looking at things and then go on and study something else. But so if you look at this discrepancy, where did it come from? Right? So here are, at the top you have the four plays that are Grand Text. And then here are the, I think I only have 12 of the Grand Text plays. Right? And you notice there's a wide variation of all of them, but in general, these four plays tend to have more nuk alone, right? 37%. These are numbers, right? So lots of nuk alone, but only one of the plays in the random sample comes close to that. All the others have very little nuk alone and mostly nuk. Some of them have a lot of nukwan, but that's fairly rare. So here are some examples from the Grand Text Corpus. Here's a duchess who says, if you didn't have, true obstacles to overcome, where would be the glory in that enterprise? Right. So she's using nuk alone. She's using nukwan. And then in another play, he says there's no wrath that can't be appeased by it. Right. So he's using the alone as well and the plan. Right. So notice how Wallstein is was a he was a dude, and we also have a duchess in the other play. Basically, these plays are they have a lot of nobles and royalty, right? But in the random plays, here you have in the Grenadier of Louis XV, there's si je ne vous donne pas ma fille, a farmer, fairly prosperous farmer who's saying that. And here you have Fanchette, who's playing a servant, who's a servant character, who's using not only ne pas, but pas without it, right? So remember how they had shown that in the Faisal de la Langue Française, they said, well, it happens in 1830, but only in these contexts, and if only you're familiar with it, think the earliest one was from 1949, and here we've got examples in this corpus from 1810. So the differences we're finding is that there were more servants, more peasants, more more bourgeois, more prosperous farmers, and a lot less nobles, right? And that seems to be the cause of there being more nobles and less noble, right? And that's where, that's the bias that the principle of authority brings to us, right? These literary critics that were consulted for the Pensée de la Française, they liked plays about these upper class characters who were using upper class language, right? And so that might have sold more dictionaries. I'm not sure, but for linguistics, it's not such a good thing because it doesn't really give us a sense of what, you know, what the average person might have heard walking down the streets of Paris, or even going into a theater. So that's basically what I found. And so what happens now? I forgot to mention, I already got statistical significance. I got a p-value of 0.05. So that means, according to student, I can move on to the next thing. So I'm looking at other time periods, for example, volume 2, 1816, 1830. I'm looking at other variables. I can tell you about some of them if you have if you want to ask any questions or in person afterwards. But it could also be expanded to other genres. Rebecca just gave me the 1 minute signal, but it looks like I think I basically said everything.